David Traub and Mike Butcher. Please give them a warm welcome. This will close our conference, and I'm sure it's worth of it to stay and listen.
Hi, everybody. Testing. One, two.
Don't do the feedback. Right?
I won't. I did it last year.
Right.
Hello.
I love the leaves, by
Where
the way.
Is all the people? Somebody go and shoot the people outside.
Digital or analog?
Actually, that's a very poor taste joke. I apologize.
Analog. Right. Let's set this up. Oh, my God. You Estonians are superhumans.
Nice audio quality. You guys are good.
I wish this was whiskey. Right. I will lose my water in this leaves. Oh, my God. This is the weirdest stage ever.
Honestly, thank you very much. This is the stuff of nightmares. I used to watch Soviet films back in the day. Obviously, I was very young. And leaves and autumnal settings seem to be eternally in these bizarre Soviet bloc Eastern European movies. There was always autumn, and always leaves.
I wonder if autumn is the time of hope.
Oh, is it? My gosh.
For us, it was spring.
With the red, the berry. What's the old Elizabethan madrigal? The berry bears the blood. Right, let's have a little opening. And hello. My name is Mike Butcher. I'm editor at large for TechCrunch. And I'm speaking to David Traub, who is a noted producer, a Hollywood player, mogul. David, welcome.
Very happy to be here with you right now and all of you.
This has really been a fascinating conference because it's really been sort of delving into the place where tech and film meet often. It's also delightful to be in Estonian Tallinn, in this beautiful city. It's very sort of evocative of creativity and art. And so I've really been enjoying it while I've been here. Let's sort of like chat, shall we? So David, I mean, you're most noted most recently for being a producer at of the Jobs movie. Steve Jobs, called Jobs, I wanted to ask, like, right on the outset, is that when you were analysing Jobs himself, what were the kinds of things that sort of struck you about the guy in terms of his approach to technology, which was so informed by art as well?
I had an answer. I'm going to come back to that answer, but I was reflecting on a conversation at lunch today, and I was briefed a few weeks ago on our conversation and some of the possible topics. And one of the topics was, what is it about Silicon Valley? What is it about the water? Why is it that Netflix can come out of Silicon Valley and not other places? So I came up with a list of 10, 15 different points, and maybe we'll come back to that later. But the first point that popped into my head, which is one that I've been grappling with lately, we were talking about it over lunch today, is it seems that there's one thing in common with most of the titans, including Steve Jobs, and maybe Steve Jobs was the penultimate example, and that's modest pathology.
What do you mean by that?
Pathology, well, Steve Jobs was an orphan. He was deeply driven to prove himself and beat Bill Gates, and then it went on from there. His goal was to have the biggest company in the world, and he actually pulled it off. I was hired on that movie, and it's a longer story, but because I knew him, and I knew him over the years. There's a Canadian phrase I'll use. He was not a happy ducky. And he was very driven.
He's a tortured soul.
He was a tortured soul by choice. When his real father came back and presented himself,
his Syrian father,
he refused him because he didn't want to break his mythology. He didn't want to change his, you know, the story by which he's driven. And I come at all of this stuff as a mental health educator, as a psychotherapist. I look at everybody. And when you start thinking about the folks that have the biggest companies in the world, with the exception of Bill Gates, and I've met a lot of these folks, Larry Ellison, not very nicest fellow. Steve Ballmer. I mean, I don't want to say anything that's going to get me in trouble.
Difficult personalities, I think.
Very difficult. The only person that I ever met that was truly a titan or still is a titan is Bill Gates. I started interacting with him maybe 30 years ago. He's a very nice and sweet guy. The only thing that's tough about him is when he talks, he rocks. So it's kind of, his brain is going.
He's got Asperger's or something.
Yeah, exactly. But then, they say that Elon Musk has the same. And apparently he's a very difficult person. And apparently the secret's been broken that Amazon is an insanely unfun place to work at.
They vehemently denied.
Of course they did. And they also fired the reporter who broke the story, who then told them, but I don't actually work for you. But they were just, they thought they were Donald Trump. You're fired.
Freelance journalist. You can't fire freelance journalists.
I'm a few months older than you, so please ask me the question again.
I'm enjoying this. Do you think it's possible to build something like Apple or Microsoft without being a tortured soul? Do you think that torture is part of creativity?
The good news is...
The tortured artist.
The good news is that most of us have some torture in our childhoods. Most of us have things that happen to us so that we all potentially... have the driver or the drives. I personally look at all the things that have happened to us, both good and bad, as gifts that you have to interpret to your advantage. But the very question you're asking is one that I ask myself a lot lately, because I'm pretty happy to be who I am. I've had a lot of therapy. I've given a lot of therapy. I still have that tick.
Why did you have to have therapy?
I had writer's block. I grew up during a time when they didn't diagnose people with dyslexia and ADD and OCD and all these things. And all I knew is that I had a tough time writing, so I had to work harder.
A happier time, probably.
It was a happier time. I ducked the bullet, didn't get any of the drugs that they give kids today, which they never should do, I think, in most cases. But it was a wonderful thing to work harder and be who I am. And we're all different. We're all who we are supposed to be. But I am not a person who is tortured. I sleep very well at night. But I have an important mission. I mean, I'm here right now as a manifestation of my mission. And my mission in life is to use the power of movies, television, AR, VR technology to help everybody realize their purpose, their mission, their contribution to the planet, because I think things are getting tougher. And I really think that all of us need to wake up, but most of us never even know that we have a purpose or this contribution to make, because we haven't been sufficiently tortured to, or not tortured, but driven, I guess driven is the operative term, to break free from our parents or our cultures and run away. I ran away. I live in a place of runaways, by the way.
You ran away from your parents?
I did.
Why?
I woke up in my second year at the Naval Academy, kind of against my will, as a midshipman. I'm kind of the furthest thing from a...
You're in the Navy.
I was more than the Navy.
It doesn't say that in your bio. Yeah,
of course it doesn't.
Why did you put it in that? Are you afraid of putting that in your bio?
More than the Navy. It was the Naval Academy. I was training to be
an officer.
An officer.
Ah, right.
And I figured, where could I go that was a million miles away, not only from the military, but my strongish father. And that's how I got to Berkeley in the West Coast.
Are you a hippie?
Unfortunately, I didn't have the hair to support it. But I have I have a card that allows me to go to Grateful Dead concerts. See, I gave it away. I've never been to one. I call them conferences. Proof that I've been doing too many conferences. But the question of, can somebody evolve to make the world and have a measurable impact without being deeply driven and unhappy? And I think that the answer has to be yes, but it's still as yet somewhat unproven.
You say that your mission in life is to deliver biopsychosocial value.
Biopsychosocial literacy.
Isn't that just a lot of sort of West Coast bullshit?
Are you from England or something?
Yes.
And European?
No, I'm British.
Okay, exactly. Pound for pound means something different to you than other folks. It's very funny about the term mental health. When I finished my thesis, my undergraduate thesis in 1984, I was given a very good grade. I studied the Soviet propagandist filmmakers who wove together the Soviet Union by inventing a modern kind of cinema called montage that works the way the brain does. If every one of you, just for a moment, looks to your left or your right, look over here, you'll notice that you saw none of this information as you went. Your brain edited out. Now, cinema before montage was a single long shot camera. You didn't identify. Sorry. I use humor wherever I can. Mostly people don't notice because it's not humor, but I try. But anyway, I got a very good grade on my thesis, but I was told it was a failure. And I was told it was a failure because there's five kinds of learning, and the only kind of learning that film really impacts in a deep and measurable way is what they call then attitudinal learning. And I said, what's attitudinal learning? He goes, well, we call it mental health, but you're not really allowed to say that. So the new term for mental health is now biopsychosocial literacy. The CDC, that's now the metric that they use to evaluate young people. But no one ever uses the term mental health because it means schizophrenia
usually means negative things.
Negative things. Yeah. And also we have so many lawyers in the United States that they're now doing massage and they're in the police force. I mean, we have too many. But you know, there's a lot of liability if you try to do something in the mental health domain because it's a soft science. So I wrote biopsychosocial literacy because that's really my primary interest. When people ask me what I do in life, as often as I can, I'll tell people I'm a mental health educator who uses movies, television, et cetera, as my classroom or my couch, I suppose.
It's your canvas.
My canvas.
Now, I love the fact that you were on the Lawnmower Man, because this movie had profound effect on me, certainly, in the sense that, firstly, I thought it was a little bit bizarre. And secondly, actually, in retrospect, it was quite visionary, because that's exactly what people are talking about now, the coming together of two things, sort of virtual reality, virtual worlds, robotics, and artificial intelligence. And, you know, in a kind of, you know, a very sort of early 90s manner, the movie obviously is slightly... obviously, of its era.
Pierce Brosnan had hair back then.
Pierce Brosnan had hair. Yeah, he
actually he's a great guy, and he still does.
He's a nice chap, isn't he? Not that I know.
Loves the oceans.
I'm a fan of his work, especially the James Bond era. What was he? Was he in Remington Steele or something? Wasn't it? Gosh, that was hilarious. Lawnmower Man. So you did that. I mean, you must think now, you know, what the heck? You know, we came up with a bunch of ideas that are actually basically coming true now.
Well, first of all, I have to give credit to where credit's massively due, and it wasn't me. It was to Brett Leonard and his late wife and partner, Jameel Everett. And the way it worked out was I first put on a VR headset. I think it was in 87. Or so. It was at Autodesk. And I later went on to do the homage to Evans and Sutherland that really invented it. But I put this head-mounted display on, and they put a tennis racket in my hand, and suddenly I was there playing tennis with a teapot. And because I was already an educator, I saw the instant possibilities of where this could go for teaching physics and chemistry, but also modeling, you know, psychological scenarios. So my graduate school thesis was I literally designed a game called The Family Room using systems theory and family systems theory, where you could design your parents, your siblings, yourself as rich computer-generated characters using machine-based learning and AI-based storytelling with a couple other tools. I reverse-engineered the DSM-3 at the time, which is the book they use to analyze people's mental health, and I use that to create stories using scripting theory and emotions theory. Every emotion, by the way, is completely scriptable and predictable. So you can literally program emotions into characters. And they thought I was a little bit crazy, but they let me do it. They were fascinated. And I got hired as head of technology for a children's television company in Silicon Valley. From there, and this big dude comes walking up to me with long hair. I still remember the hair flip. Again, I hope he doesn't see this someday, but he still does it. He's got a lot of hair still. And he came up to me and said, "You're the technology guy. You ever hear of something called virtual reality?" And I go, "Well, here's my thesis from 3 years ago." And he goes, "Oh my God, I need your help." And he invited me to be the VR consultant on The Lawnmower Man. And I went on to actually bring in most of the graphic artists that did all the display graphics. So I was definitely party to that movie and its manifestation, but really it was Brett Leonard's, you know, vision.
But he couldn't have done it without your help.
Well, you know, I helped him for sure. But I will say that movie then brought me to EMI North America, where I started writing their downloading strategy. And next thing I know, I was producing 3D games for rock bands. And that all happened because of The Lawnmower Man. It was the biggest break in my life until the Steve Jobs movie.
So TechCrunch, TechCrunch is a massive blog about startups and virtual venture capital and stuff like that. And we have a big conference called Disrupt. And this year, in San Francisco in September, we had a massive area of VR startups. And, you know, I can see that already that there's going to be a lot of, you know, failure and a lot of people falling away. But at the moment, there's a real sort of boom in that area. And as a journalist, I covered the Clouds Over Sidra virtual reality, 360-degree movie that was shot in a Syrian refugee camp in Jordan, which the United Nations backed. Now, you're an observer of both the technology space, you know, you're an investor, an angel investor, you've been in that area, and you're in the film world. Do you think there's going to be just a lot of creative destruction, as it were, in this area in terms of startups, first of all, and also the movie side of it, yeah, sort of the creative side of it?
Well, in terms of destruction, they're already predicting that the crash is going to be in the spring. And, you know, I don't know. I heard the number, someone, I don't remember where it is, so it's anecdotal, that there's at least 1,000 people out there now, you know, pitching VR, mostly VR movie companies, which is, I think there's going to be some very interesting stuff. And I know some of the folks, you know, Chris Melk and, you know, some of the, you know, there's some people.
Chris Melk shot Clouds Over Sidra.
Yeah, this great guy in London, also Drew. I think.
So you think there's going to be a lot of a big shakeout?
There's going to be a big shakeout. I mean, there's so much money floating around. Another number I heard was about $1 billion. The venture fund.
Just in VR?
Just in VR. The fund Rautenberg has done 17 investments. This was as of last, I guess, 4 or 5 months ago. I know a lot of the funds are looking at it. The Drapers, Kosla, they're all looking at it. They're all scratching their head. Because like 2000, the business model is not obvious. It's not even this Christmas. People are saying, it's the same sick Kool-Aid. But having said that, what's really unique about VR and AR, which I believe is going to be, 10 to 100 times bigger than VR, is the fact that like film, it really reflects, the future, which is really the past. And what I mean to say is, the things that really do work are things that really do augment humans, that really find a way to mimic what we do and do it and help us do it better. Film is very good film. Montage film is very powerful because if you do it right, you're in a blackened, you have a large screen, a blackened room, you forget that you're in a film and you process the data as if it's real. And so you therefore get to go on a life experience that you wouldn't normally have in your own life. Of course, the challenge is that there's somebody that's manipulating you, but you bought into that manipulation. VR is interesting because what's it trying to do? It's trying to replicate reality. It's an experience where you go into a world as if it were real. Again, it's being manipulated by an auteur in some cases, or a machine in others, or both, which is, I think, where the future is going. Again, Brett Leonard, who is an amazing visionary, It's done about $500 million in box office. The Lawnmower Man really set him up. Has this whole theory of narrative relative to VR, and without compromising it, it addresses the notion that there's primary, secondary, tertiary narrative events going on. You have an auteur with the primary story trying his best to get a suspension of disbelief and keep you with him without losing that relationship. At the same time, people are looking left and looking right, and it makes sense that you then would default to a gaming metaphor.
This is the thing. This is my problem with it, in the sense that, you know, having watched a few 360 movies, when you're looking, you're kind of worried that you're going to miss some action around the corner that's like crucial to a story or whatever.
That's a good point.
Yeah, and Charity Water, the charities at the moment is about to release something where you experience what it's like to be a young child in Ethiopia trying to, you know, gather water, and it takes you hours or every day. And then they come with their big truck and they drill a well, and it's amazing and everyone's so happy. But you're kind of thinking, hold on, did I just miss something around the corner? You know, something a little bit crucial to the whole pitch of the piece, you know?
You know, it's funny. The two fellows from ICM yesterday, and they were great, were talking about the fact that what used to be indie films are now television series, and they're stretching out. And one of the conversations that came up was about the fact that you can go back and see something again and again, and that showrunners are becoming the go-to guys for the future of VR movies, namely because the money is going to come from the corporate world, and they're going to want to know you can deliver. And one of the mantras that turned out to not really work very well was the notion that people really want to interact and have impact on the outcome of a story. Turned out that wasn't really true. But there's this mantra, well, they'll go on and see this thing 5 times or 10 times, because every time you go through it, it's a different experience. But at the same time, it's maybe not the experience that you really want to have, because you're not allowing yourself to be taken by a director who knows how to tell a great story.
Yeah,
that's a good point.
Storytelling, yeah. I think people are still having to work out how they're going to tell these stories. Why do you think AR is going to be bigger than VR, augmented reality?
Yeah, you know, the difference by definition is VR is self-contained environment. Right now, it's more or less by yourself, but there are multiple people working on social VR. There's a company called Pantomime that allows you to do VR on all your devices at the same time, with head-mounted display or your phone. There's other, I'm trying to remember some of the other names of companies out there. I have a feeling that, but AR is augmented reality, and you can call it augmented reality, but it's really augmented humanness. It's, you know, AR comes out of the military 20 or 30 years ago, when you have telemetry being projected in front of you, so you don't have to look at a monitor somewhere. And then Tom Cruise, I don't remember the name of the movie, but it's always the case. It's always the model. What was the Tom Cruise movie that he did where there was telemetry and people could track everybody?
Minority Report.
Minority Report. That's a great example of augmented reality. The thing about augmented reality is it's going to be with us all the time. You know, it's inevitable.
Google Glass was a massive success, though, wasn't it?
I like your American humor. I was trying to be British with my humor and be deadpan, but I didn't do it very well. Google Glasses did not do well, but it's still very visionary. And and you've got glasses. You're an augmented human.
I'm watching a movie right now.
I know that. And
now I'm watching the football.
It's T-rated, you know, for Traub, which is not for children. Augmented reality, you know, we're all cybers. You have glasses. I've got 3 artificial hearts because I was greedy. And envious.
Let me press you on this. Why do you think that, in simple terms, why do you think AR is bigger? Because it enhances. Let's be honest. It's, you know, there's lots of industrial applications. You know, you want to put a nut and bolt onto a 747. You need to know what it looks like. That kind of thing. But in terms of you know, this world, is there a sort of an AR movie out there waiting to be made?
No, it's the Beck concert that Chris Melk did, which is more or less, or maybe the project in the Middle East project, those are sort of given as the penultimate example. Maybe some of the guys the guys up in Montreal, Felix and forget the last name right now. Those are examples of the really amazing VR experiences that you can't get any other way. There is no sexy example yet of AR, so it's a little bit challenging. It's a little bit in the future because nobody's come up with it yet. But having said that, AR, you know, again, it's maybe it's misnamed. It's just the use of technologies to expand, enhance your experience. I went to a venture pitch about 2 months ago. There were four AR companies, and they were all audio companies. And they all enhance the experience of listening, hearing, entertainment. I mean, I was actually, you know, any technology which gives you a better experience of life would be called, would considered AR. And I just have to believe, and I'm a big believer that wearable computing is going to be interesting. I really believe in filters. I believe that there's a lot of value that computing and AI can give us in social situations downstream, where there's a keyword could trigger the fact that we're having trouble and we have an awkward situation. I feel it, but I can't articulate it because it doesn't exist yet. But that's an important thing, because if it exists, it may be too late for you as an entrepreneur. There is something to be said for when you have a gut feeling about a new opportunity, or better, a void. Voids are better than niches, by the way, because there's probably something to it. There is a continuum of opportunity where if it's too resolved and too clear, you may be too late.
You're involved in an industry body about AR, VR, aren't you? And there's obviously a lot of companies associated with that. That's LA-based, I presume, yeah?
Toronto.
Toronto. Oh, I
apologize. Frisky Canadians. Americans without ego. Except maybe Toronto. I hope there's no one here from Toronto.
What, you prefer Montreal, do you?
I love Montreal. Vancouver's nice, too, although they miss the snow.
That's true.
Anybody here from Canada? It's
Only one. All right, carry on. We can be rude.
It's like, in a way, it's like going to China without having to, you know, fly for 14 hours. It's unbelievable now, the density. It's become a, you know, a very global place. I was just there last week at a film festival, and there were 10 times more Chinese than there were, you know, Caucasians. It's very interesting.
This is a kind of interesting, because what's been happening, I mean, China's been investing in film studios over the last couple of years.
And I could talk about this because I have experience.
Well, this is what I'm happy you can, because one of the things is going on is this sort of projection of soft power now globally, and using Hollywood, using movies to, obviously it didn't quite work with The Interview, did it? The North Korean assassination movie.
No.
That projection of soft power didn't sort of quite come off. Although,
I'm
in a way,
not
it
sure
sort of
the
did,
jury's
didn't it?
Totally
out. They got a little hot under the collar, the North
right,
Koreans.
But look at all the PR it got. And the movie made its money back, apparently.
Oh, yeah. Do you think they engineered all of that press?
You know, it's still, and it's funny, actually, I got caught in a little bit of the crossfire. I'm peripherally involved in some activities that came out in secret emails, which was really funny. I mean,
please go on.
I can't.
No, please. It's just amongst friends.
One of the relationships I have, which is a European relationship, was involved at a studio level with finance. And it was very embarrassing because some of those letters came out at very high levels. And they were
about
horrified.
How much people were paid and stuff.
Yeah, whatever. Yeah, and they were horrified. And someone said, be happy. Watch what happens. Because they wanted to deny it and this and that. You know, within an hour, the phone was ringing with people saying, hey, can you get me a bunch of money? In other words, all PR is good PR, even bad PR.
As per the Oscar Wilde
exactly.
phrase.
Exactly. China.
China. So are we going to see, how can I put it? China's going to get involved. Does that mean Hollywood's going to start producing a lot more movies that are kind of nice about dictators?
I like that. Let me see. What have they produced there recently? They did...
Softer Side of Dictatorship, perhaps?
Yeah, you know, I can just see it on Broadway with a little tap dance.
Springtime in
me and
Beijing.
You. That's right. You know, springtime in Beijing with whatever.
Mao Zedong.
Exactly. Mao Zedong. That's good.
We better not go on the road here.
You know.
We know. What do you think? Let's get our agents to talk.
Exactly. Or our
I'll
Asians.
I'll have my people talk
or
to
our
your people.
Or our Asians.
Yes.
I'll have my people conference call your people.
Oh, this is good. Can I use that? Oh, that's great. I'll get my, yeah, can, my VC can talk.
Soft power.
We have to take that into Silicon Valley.
Soft power, I am completely an advocate of soft power. I live my life for it. I mean, my purpose in life has never been to be successful and make it and be in a studio. My power as an educator, I know I told you that yesterday, is to have as much positive impact as I can in a manner that's not offensive and obviously and hopefully not obvious. And the Chinese are very smart. They don't call it social impact. They call it family movies. And I have a, you know, I have a project unfolding there, and I was able to bring some money to the table from China to the Steve Jobs movie. There's a lot of money there, but their intentions are quite explicit. They want to learn. They want to learn how to produce global movies.
Have you been to China much?
Many. I've given 9 speeches there in the last 18 months, mostly on producing transmedia. Single story derivations to the across the waterfall as it makes sense.
What sort of reception are you getting?
Did
I get it, or are they still learning?
I was going to do another audio joke, but I won't go there on the reception. So, very friendly. If you have something that they want, you know, they're lovely, you know, and
well, obviously,
I suppose that's true, but anywhere, isn't it? I got to be really careful.
What's going on underneath,
last time
though?
I was here, I made a joke, and my mother called me on it, because and that was. I have to be really be careful to remember this stuff may get broadcast sometimes. So,
yes.
I have done comedy before, but it's past tense because it turned out I wasn't funny. But in any case, go on.
What I wanted to know is, obviously they want to learn, and you know the film industry obviously is extremely well developed. You know, obviously for. In China, but the
at the same time, it's not though.
Right. Well, in what way is it not then?
You know, it's very frenetic. I don't know why I say this, but in a way, it's like a kung fu movie. You know, it's there's an informality to it. But that's not always totally true. One of the speeches I gave was to the August 1st studios, and I wasn't forewarned when I went into this. I was in Chengdu. And it was Yangshui, which are those beautiful mountains that inspired James Cameron to do Avatar. I don't know if you remember those floating mountains. Those are almost exact replicas of the mountains of Chengdu, which are amazing. We arrived for our first of 7 days of a vacation, which is how I got my wife and my son to go over there with me. And the first night we're there, I got a phone call. David, you must come to Beijing tomorrow. The tickets are waiting for you. And I go, why? He says, trust me. And I was wondering if I was speaking to Ronald Reagan when I heard that trust me thing. But if I got 3 laughs, I'm satisfied. Anyway, he's too old for you. I woke up the next morning and I was in a theater like this, and there wasn't a person in the room that wasn't at least a major in the Chinese army. Literally, the generals were in the front row, and they were bummed out. They were really unhappy. The reason why is because the young people weren't watching their movies. I started saying wars. That was Freudian slip. But I can use Freudian metaphors because this is Europe, correct?
You can.
Okay. They were trying to figure out, well, how do we get the young people to watch our movies? And then they told me about the big project they're doing.
Was this for recruitment purposes or what?
No, propaganda.
Right.
Right. And
good old propaganda.
And I said, you know, they told me the movie they're doing, which I won't disclose. And I said, you should do it like Rashomon. You should do it so you have the authentic perspective of the Chinese people, the authentic perspective of the Americans. So I love that movie, how they showed with authenticity the integrity of each of the sides, so that you understand that people, you don't have one side with passionate and fighting for their country, and the other side thinking, dude, they're paying me, man. You know, I mean, everybody really believes in themselves, or at least a lot of the people do. And, but they said, we'll think about that. But I don't know if that happened or not.
Who's playing who? Who's playing who? Is Hollywood playing China, or is China playing Hollywood?
I would have to say that China's playing Hollywood. They've been at it for 5,000 years.
They've got history.
Yeah, and I also think about that analogy when I'm thinking about Iran. I mean, you know, I think it's very hard.
You mean
to,
the opening up of Iran?
Exactly. I just think it's very challenging. There's a big difference between 5,000 years of experience and maybe a couple hundred years of experience, but that's another conversation and another movie, but let's not go there right now. So
you heard it here first.
Exactly.
The interview in Iran.
The interview, that's right, starring Jackie Chan and Dan Aykroyd. anyway, you know something, first of all, when people are honest, I think people know it. And I think there's wonderful people everywhere, everywhere on the planet. And we all have, you know, we all have needs and desires, and, you know, cultures can teach us, you know, different levels, you know, can measure integrity relative to other values. But I don't think that there are a lot of people in China or anywhere that are, you know, that are earnestly trying to, I don't know. That's another story. And again, I want to be careful.
Look, I'm sorry, David, I'm going to interrupt your West Coast psycho babble.
I'm from the East Coast,
sorry.
By the way.
I apologize.
And originally England, Mayflower baby.
Oh, right. So originally.
So now it's going to warm up. Watch his body language.
Oh.
The legs
better.
Are going to switch.
Now I like you.
Half Canadian.
In terms of, you know, the control of the industry, you know, TechCrunch, we are, you know, we're obsessed with the bit, we call them GAFTA, Google, Apple, Facebook, Twitter, Amazon. Note that there's no mention.
Kind of like BAT, Baidu, yeah. Alibaba, Tencent.
Yeah, that kind of thing.
Right.
Yeah. Note that we don't mention Microsoft anymore, poor things. You know, I mean, the ownership of the data around audiences now is shifting into tech. You know, it's moving away from Hollywood. Netflix knows what's being watched. Amazon knows what's being watched and bought. Apple knows what's being watched and bought. Hollywood is, you know, the puppet on the end of the string, really, these days, isn't it? No?
You know, good news and bad news. I'm really excited by the shift north, Netflix, although they've got a place down in L.A., Apple's going to start producing content. That's the strong rumor now. Amazon.
As well as cars, apparently.
They go together. And by the way, somebody said yesterday, if you want to know a good group, an industry to sell content to, it's going to be cars, because you're going to have a lot of time on your hands, which I actually thought was quite a brilliant idea. I don't remember who said that, but... But anyway, I love about the fact that the distribution model is moving north, even though it hasn't made up for theatrical in any way at all or for DVDs, is that, and by the way, I have founder stock in a bunch of companies. I'm entrepreneurial, so that's one of the things that I also dig about this conversation, is I'm on both sides of the fence. You know what you're going to get paid when you're working with Netflix or Apple or any of those people. You get 70%. That's a lot better than 10%, and you'll probably never get any percent after what you get up front. I mean, that's just the way it works in Hollywood. When people say, oh, you work in Hollywood, I don't. I purposely live in the Bay Area, and, you know, and so I like the fact that I know what I'm going to get paid. The downside is that digital VOD, those revenue streams don't yet compare to theatrical yet, or at least theatrical, the money that goes to the exhibitors, they get 50, 60%, whatever it is, and then the distributor, which gets 50% of the rest, and the numbers, we don't get those numbers. So, you know, one of the things that I've been doing is developing a list of things I would do to advise the EU on how to really make this digital single market a wonderful thing for everybody. And one of the things that I really think, I heard something yesterday which I love, I never heard before. P&A, and it's really misnamed, it's really E&A. It was always called prints and ads, but they don't do prints anymore, so I call it E&A, engagement in ads, which is basically the all-important promotion of a movie so that the brand is made available to the world. That's the greatest value that the studios bring. They do it so well, so the world knows your movie. The challenge is, they then take all the rights for doing that, or so many of the rights for doing that, and they make it very challenging. But the issue is rights, and the issue is accountability. If we could actually have laws in the EU where distribution and Netflix and these behemoths as well are forced to open up the books to share that data, you know, in a more democratic way. That's a win-win for everybody. So that, God forbid, somebody like me.
They would hate that, though, wouldn't they?
Of course they would. But 300 million people or 330 million people in Europe is a nice market. Having said that, one of my movies is a movie on a Bangladeshi girl, a 9-year-old girl, who dresses as a boy so that she doesn't have to be a sex worker or work in a textile company to make money for her family. And in the process of raising money to do that film, I found out that there's 330 million Tamils. And there aren't a lot of movies that are being written for that audience. And I've been working a little bit in Nollywood, working with a Nollywood project. And I'm stunned to find out that there will be 700 million Nigerians, supposedly, in the next 10 years. And it's the second most prolific film market in the world right now. So there are all these tremendous opportunities. And guys like me, who are not the last one in, the first one out, which is E&A, we're the first ones in and the last ones out, and we never really get out. That's really uncomfortable. Fortunately, we don't necessarily do it for the money. You can't say that, of course. We need the money. We have families. But you don't do it, you know, knowing that you're going to make a lot of money, especially if you're in the indie world, especially if you want to do social impact or family films, as the Chinese say.
Soft power. Back to the EU, though. There's been a lot of chat here about the digital single market and that kind of thing. Are you saying that we should create a fortress Europe a scenario where, which is to some extent where some of the political stuff is going, in terms of, say, the refugee crisis, that you know, it's pay to play. You know, you get to play in Europe if you're, you know, you're part of our digital single market and you open up a heck of a lot more data than normally you might do in the States.
So the key to selling is never tell people what you can do for them, or worse, what you want and what your mandate is. It's to figure out what your target's problem is and package yourself as a solution. So when looking at the digital single market, you have to think to yourself, who's my client? What's the problem I'm trying to solve? The complexity of the issue is that there are multiple clients. There are the consumers, which is what everybody waves. There are the what they call diversity, which is really the producers that they're trying to nurture. And I don't believe in the phrase protect diversity. I believe in birthing and facilitating the evolution of diverse producers, you know, and directors, and, you know, the talent, whatever you want to say. So that's a second clientele. The third clientele, of course, is the cultural mandate of the EU itself. You can't forget the national mandates as well, because there is the national factor involved. But then there are other clients that you have to consider as important that are even outside of the fortress of Europe, namely entities that have distribution in other parts of Europe. Digital single market isn't just about digital single market. It's about helping filmmakers from the EU be more successful beyond the digital single market of Europe, projecting the soft power, the values, etc. I was asked by one of our lovely attendees here, you know, what do we do about Paris? You know, how, you know, Paris is probably just the beginning. And I, you know, my answer was immediate.
The attacks, you mean?
My answer was immediate, because this is who I am. I'm a mental health educator, saying got to go for the youth immediately. And that's all about teaching young people through the medias that they listen to and trust, versus their teachers, for example, or versus perhaps even their parents, who may have, you know, a set of circumscribed values, but they may not have had that biopsychosocial literacy themselves. There's a statistic in the United States, which of course doesn't apply to Europe, which is either 76 or 80% of Americans would not be considered mainline psychologically healthy, according to this book. In other words, 15 or 25% of the population would be considered happy, healthy, well-rounded. And then the rest of the population, because of divorce or alcohol or whatever it is. So the number is probably different in Europe, but who knows what it is. I don't know what it is. But I would say that you need to use the soft power of media for positive goals and expressing values without violating cultural mandates or telling people what they need to do.
I think everything's become far too politically correct. Everyone's walking on eggshells, trying to, you know, look up EU rules for this, EU rules for that. Shouldn't the market decide?
I think that people need to be honored for being artists. I think you're always going to have artists who are going to do things that are radical and anti-establishment, because again, artists are entrepreneurs without a portfolio. Entrepreneurs are driven by something. Artists are driven by something, typically childhood-based. This is why psychology is such a rich domain by which to look at economic development and the development of media. And so there needs to be, people need to have the freedom to manifest their expression, their anger, et cetera, et cetera. At the same time, if they want to be able to get more money and more capacity, they need to also do things that are commercially. One of the fellows from ICM yesterday, and I don't know if they're in the audience, said that, if it was his client, he'd say, do your art film and then do a commercial film and show people you can handle a bigger budget. So I think that there need to be film festivals honoring art and expression, but there also need to be film festivals that honor soft power. And people need to recognize the value of soft power when Al-Qaeda and ISIS are using soft power so incredibly effectively to recruit and really put the world at risk. And I think that using soft power to forewarn people of the rising oceans or the decline of arable land or whatever it is, and most people call that documentary, and I'm a big supporter of documentaries, but I'm not a giant supporter of documentaries because I don't believe enough people ever see them. And I also don't believe they're sustainable from a business model perspective relative to a feature film that may address those issues. Interstellar.
You don't think Al Gore can save, the likes of Al Gore can save the world?
Well, don't underestimate him because he pretty much invented everything, right?
Yeah, the internet.
I know, starting with the internet. Actually, I know him, and I think his intentions were quite positive until he reached the billionaire status. And then maybe, but in any case, and again, that's my humor. It gets me in trouble. I actually have a lot of respect for his intent. You know, he wasn't trying to promote the tobacco industry. He was trying to promote, environmental values. So,
you think that documentary has its place, but that
absolutely, but I really do believe, this is not how I was born or how I was raised. I'm probably confusing to, again, I don't want to say anything about, those before me. But I now find myself very idealistic and committed and driven to using media as quickly and as powerfully as I can to wake people up to realities they're not aware of yet because they haven't traveled or, for whatever it is, or they're too buried in their survival.
Feature
films are seen by a lot more people.
If you yourself are at this interesting confluence between media, film, art, creativity, and technology, Why have you not applied some of your thoughts to becoming a unicorn and creating the next Snapchat or the next whatever?
That's not why I'm here.
Don't you? Are you jealous of technology in Silicon Valley?
No, I have founder stock in 41 companies. I get approached by so many companies, but I'm blessed by the fact that the American rules are so challenging that guys like me without registrations can't raise money anymore. Unless we're part of a venture. And I'm almost 60 years old. I know it's hard to believe. I look like I'm 58 or something.
I know.
Exactly. Good.
I often get that problem as well.
Oh, yeah, but you need to look young in your biz, right?
Yes.
You're talking to all those young celebrities.
Yes. Millennials.
Exactly. I can't even spell it right. That's how old I am. So I think that the moment that we know who we are, whether it's true or not, the moment that you convince yourself that you know your purpose, you have to do it. And I actually turned down a job at Microsoft in 1985 that I was told was worth probably nine figures.
Are you not bitter about that?
No regrets. No? I don't believe in regrets. No, it gives me a great story.
In a little bit?
No, my wife.
Can I not bring you over to the bitter side of the universe?
My wife has asked me gingerly, why I didn't do it, and she might have sworn somewhere in there. But no, I believe everything happens perfectly. I've created a spiritual system for myself. I'm sort of a faux Northern California Buddhist. You know, I believe everything's perfect. And
you do LSD?
Not anymore, because I forget now. It impacted my memory. So I just smoke a lot.
I get the same problem
in the shower,
from tequila.
You know, when it's really cold out, I smoke, you know.
So what are you most excited by right now? I mean, there's, you know, like I said, looking at the stands, the VR stands at TechCrunch Disrupt this year, I just thought there's going to be a heck of a lot of blood on the walls. And somebody's going to figure it out, though. And you've got, you know, a lot of these other kinds of approaches to whether it be sort of the creative side of VR or, you know, virtual worlds. Or I saw a fantastic kind of homemade hologram system done the other day with an Oculus Rift and a PlayStation or something. Is Hollywood still jealous of Silicon Valley's, you know, ability to control the platforms, and or do you think that they need each other?
Well, first of all, I mean, there's three questions. Let me see if my brain can remember them. The first one is, what am I really, really excited about right now? I'm not really excited about technology in of itself. And at this stage of my life...
You must be excited about some companies, perhaps.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'll come to that. Right now, you know, except perhaps to help my family, you know, very much on the side to, you know, force multiply somebody by virtue of my relationships globally, I'm not really interested in a company that makes faster routers or faster chips or any of those things. You know, what really excites me at this point in my life is some of the movies, the transmedia platforms. I get so excited by this. This is what allows me to sleep at night and have, you know, the energy of, you know, I don't know, somebody in my middle 30s maybe, a little bit older than you. And but that's what excites me more than anything. There are technologies that I'm excited about happening because they're important to my bigger vision, and I am a technology guy by background. Done a little programming, went to the media lab when I was at, you know, grad school, doing stuff there. I'm really excited about AI as it relates to storytelling. I'm really interested in AI.
You're not worried about the robots harvesting us for our organs?
Isn't it already happening? That's what don't we call that, Starbucks?
Yes, that's true, actually.
Yeah, so I'm very, I have a project in that area as well, believe it or not. So it is an issue. But I really do believe on the cover sheet to my graduate school thesis, I wrote, technology is neither good nor evil. It depends on how you use it. And I think that there's a lot of value. But I did meet a woman, a sort of a superhuman woman at a party last 4th of July. She was a gorgeous, brilliant Chinese. And I have this little game. I was in the military. You know, because I'm so global, I do brush arms sometimes with intelligence people, and you know, they're out there, you know, doing the same things we are, but they have an agenda. They're trying to, you know, get on to things and
trying to kill Edward Snowden, stuff like that.
Putin will do that, but that's another. Let's not go there yet. I don't know. I think that he was heroic. He might have gone a little far, but he was absolutely heroic, and he really had a massive impact. Maybe a strong impact. We don't really know how much impact he really had. Anyway, it was a really an important moment in time. But anyway, I met this woman, and I kind of somehow or other, you know, figured out that she was in that business, and she was a genius and a martial artist and really an amazing woman. And she asked me the question, "What's your greatest fear in life?" And I had just been exposed to some very interesting data on the rising oceans and the implications of that. And I live in a place that's a couple feet above sea level, and it's already hitting us. And I go, what about you? And she said, killer AI. And she meant it. She meant it. And you can tell when someone's serious. And so I think 50 years from now, I think that is going to be, I mean, I remember seeing only 6 months ago, the South Koreans have AI-based machine guns on their border, and I saw them on a news show, and they have infrared cameras, and you can't spoof them, you can't, And that's a little bit of a look as to where things might be going there. But we're quite deviating from China. By the way, I'm jet lagged. Can you imagine me on coffee?
Do you foresee a time when movies will be written by AI?
So I see that already happening to a degree, and let me tell you about that from two different skews. One is the Media Lab skew. The other one is the VR skew. And it's really a gaming skew. Think about what happens when you go into a game right now. There's a feature film, basically. I mean, they spend $50 million on these 10 minute movies, setting the stage for these interactive stories. And how's the story unfolding in those games? It's AI, it's physics, it's gaming physics. And it gets better and better and better.
But in terms of the storytelling, I mean, we're familiar with all of the, you know, the bells and whistles of, right, of blue screen technology, et cetera.
Yeah, so going back to VR, you've got a director. You may have a director that's trying to be the primary level. Secondary and tertiary auteur is a machine already. So we're moving in that direction. We're moving in the direction of, because gaming, you know, story is basically rule-based, right? So AI is rule-based. You know, you've got stories, characters, emotions. You have a three-act play. Each act has three beats. I mean, it's just a formula. So then, but the other way I want to look at it is, and I want to make a comment on the leaves before we finish. The other way to look at it is in the early 1980s, MIT did an experiment with a therapist. And it was a very interesting experiment where they tried to figure out if an AI could be more believable than a human being.
Was this a Turing test?
It wasn't a Turing test. Look up Media Lab, computer-based therapist. Try to remember what the name is. It was a very famous test. And the AI beat the human, I think, 8 out of 10 times. You know, just listening and repeating. And in fact, there was somebody made a joke out of it. There was a cassette that you could buy that literally was a therapist you could buy for $5, put the tape in, and then go to work. And every few minutes, okay, so how do you feel about that? Literally, it was just a one-sided conversation. And
sounds like Siri.
You know, it was awful, though. I got a $250 bill. You know, I didn't expect it afterwards, but I felt better. What I want to say about the leaves, by the way, is we're talking about technology, film, and AI and all these things. These are not very organic things. But the thing you need to remember is that just like these leaves, in the end, what really matters when it comes to storytelling, which is really my answer to your story, is story, character, and emotion trump. And a great example of an environment that it's Hollywood meets Silicon Valley that works is Pixar. In fact, I would say Pixar was the first really strong example of a synthesis of these cultures. You have John Lasseter, who's a great storyteller. He's a writer. And then you had, you know, these computer scientists like Alvy Ray and Lauren Carpenter, who, you know, are just incredible computer scientists. And I've seen the process of how they invent stories. When they tell a story, they don't use tools. They don't use computers. They use their hands and their gestures. And if you can't tell a story that compels the team, it doesn't work.
You don't think that if you fed every film script ever written into IBM Watson, that it would come up with an interesting plot line, perhaps, and you can fire the writers?
Sure, it's already been done. But you know, humans are smart, thank God. You know, Darwin was onto something. And I think that, you know, we become, you know, the way we learn is we receive 2 gigabytes of data a second, or the number I recently saw was 400 million bits a second. But the brain only processes about 400 bits a second. And what happens, the way it works, is we have something called an executive strategy or something like that, where we have in our brain at any given time 5 to 7 problems. And we sift through all this data. And we only grab that stuff which is relevant. That's why the job of teaching is so challenging and the job of mentoring is so rewarding. Because all you really should be doing for our children of all ages is helping teach us how to teach and help to basically guide the kinds of problems we need to solve. So I really believe, and then what happens when you get knowledge, it becomes instantiated as synopsis, becomes harder and harder, and then it gets hard to break. And, you know, fortunately, the brain has this thing called plasticity, and there's a lot of stuff going on now about brain plasticity. And I think that once something becomes a pattern, we get bored with it. And, you know, the key to teaching people is to finding ways to break that plasticity so they can learn new things. And I think that we are constantly getting bored of old narrative models. And I think computers are smart, but I think humans are smart too. And just like you said earlier on, well, I'm English, so I don't buy this West Coast stuff. You know, it's just because we get tired of what we consider to be formulaic storytelling from Hollywood. And we like some of this stuff that comes out of Slovenia and Finland and, you know, these angry young birds. You know, what's that all about? These are angry birds who had tough childhoods. You know, they were not breastfed. They were in an egg. You know, I'd be angry too if I was born in an egg.
They've got something against the pigs.
Exactly, exactly. Yeah, and those pigs haven't made until, yeah. Well, let's not go there.
The pigs with the helmets.
Exactly.
Yeah, that means something else in Britain. So therefore you're saying that if you fed all the film scripts into an AI, it would come up with something formulaic, and you would still require human beings script writers and people like you and people like here, people here to create something interesting, you know, that will excite human beings.
You know, the
we won't be taken over quite yet. Is that what
no,
you're saying?
It's a long time from now, but you know, the beautiful future that, you know, is where technology takes over the humane stuff, so we can be free to be humans. We can be less. This is an idealistic, and I think this comes out of Edinburgh. So you can blame those Scots for this one. Okay, so did I say it right? By the way, Edinburgh, not bad. I've been there once. They corrected me more than once.
Edinburgh,
exactly. Thank you. So more than once. So anyway, you know, I love.
So you're
this
saying idea. It sets us free.
It sets us free from the humdrum. The challenge is there's 7 billion of us, going to be 9 billion. And you know, there's not, you know, I heard the other day that there's about enough resources comfortably for about 4 billion. So that's not the purpose of this conversation, to address that issue right now. But, you know, we can be set free by technology to be humans. And I think humans are so complex that there's an awful lot of richness for us to have just by being in relationships with each other. You know, this is why it's tough getting married when you're 20s, because human beings grow so much that no matter how much you love yourself, the chances of you still being together, you know, as you become who you are challenging. There's so much drama and story just to be created by, you know, in between humans. But whatever happens, I think that my closing statement, at least on that issue, is that we're all evolving towards something. We are just another human being. No, we're not really special. We just have been lucky enough to go fairly far down our continuum of life purpose. I think your background's amazing. By the way, you know, I know that you feign a jaded attitude because you're British and I'm temporarily a Californian.
You mean feign?
Okay, exactly. Well, it's, you know, because I'm a Californian, so I can feel your goodness. But are you
security?
Right, security. Should I do that feedback joke again? So tell me, you know, where you are right now. I mean, you're a few months younger than me. You've really hit the, I know that, you know, AIA is not everything that was meant to be, but how do you feel about your life? Are you doing what you're supposed to be doing? I think you are, because you're doing it really well. I think if you do something well, you do amazing things, and you've got a great background. Do you believe that you're doing what you want to do, or are there other things that you want to do?
Well, as Graham Greene once said, childhood is the writer's bank balance, and I am very wealthy in that respect. So therefore, I would like to say thank you, David Trove.
Oh, you're cutting it off there? Did I cross the line?
Thank you, David Trove, for a fascinating discussion. And I thank you all for attending.
He gave me permission to interview him, and I did it way too late.
I don't know if we're going to do questions. Do we want to do questions? I think we can.
I hope we do, because that's how you learn, by the way. You get entertained by listening, but you learn by talking, and I mean that with all seriousness.
We'll allow a couple of questions. I'm not a big question fan, to be honest with you, but let's go for it. If anybody has any, if not, then we will hold it there. Don't worry. No, we'll
must
be, fine.
Be quick.
Hmm? Huh?
I will feel for the audience if you have no questions.
I don't think we need it. I think we've covered a lot. So I will say thank you very much, David. And I appreciate your time. And now we can go into therapy. Thank you.
Excellent.